So we restart our work, our seminars, our meeting, and we start with the survey on done by Kantar Society. Here the data will be presented by Nicolas Bekev. Is a quite interesting survey because we can see in a few minutes we will have a quite different position between in Europe respect to perception of radicalization, but also it's interesting, I think, to have also a more general question on the feeling about in respect to the future in the young European people. And since on this morning we spoke about this perception or about bias, systematic mistake between the reality and the perception, I'd like to comment very briefly with you to see these graphs. And this graph is on the very simple question: How many Muslim are in your country? And the first bar is about the reality, and the second one is the perception. As you can see in Belgium, in Britain, for instance, in France, there is a quite different. There are distance between the reality and the perception. As you can see, the reality is about under the 10 in all European countries, but the perception is in many cases after 20 or can arrive to 13 in France. I think that we have to comment, to have to think on this data, and we have to consider what we can do when the young people had this kind of perception, and what is the role of prevention of the work in education area. And now I ask to Nicolas to present the main data, because the data are very, very big, is a very wide sample, and to present the main data of this survey.
Thank you very much. So my name is Nicolas Bécuve. I work for Kantar Public. We are a global market research company specialized in public opinion around the world. I work in the Brussels office, Kantar Public Brussels, and we are specialized in multi-country, cross-national, political and opinion and social surveys. To start the presentation, I would say that when we designed this project, the idea was to try to understand the phenomenon of radicalization among the general public, and in that case, specifically among young people aged 14-24. So the survey results, and what's important to know when you look at the presentation, is going from the general public perception rather than going to the specific individuals. And as professor said before, there are many factors that explain radicalization, and it's really sometimes very individual factors that explain that. Our perspective is to understand whether we can feel radicalization among the general public, so a general public sample. So that's going to be the main trend. And I'm going to present the results in general, but also I'm going to focus on the Italian results through this survey. Some introduction about the methodology. So the survey was conducted in February-March 2018. It's very important, especially in the case of Italy, because it was during your national elections. We interviewed a sample of around 12,000 people in 12 countries. You see on the screen a diversity of countries from the north of Europe, from the east of Europe, from the south of Europe, and from West Europe. So we have a a wide spread of countries. The decision was based on many factors, but it was very important that we cover most Europe. And it's also it was very important, of course, that we covered countries that that were attacked by terrorism in the last years. The samples, there are two target group in our sample. One is a general public sample of people aged 14 to 24. So that's the main sample I'm going to use for the survey. And we have a comparative sample of people aged 25-50 to try to understand whether the results apply mainly to young people or they also apply to the rest of the population and is there any difference. But I'm going to mainly focus on the general public sample, age 14-24. And again, the results reflect the reality of the country. So it doesn't reflect subgroups of the population that we may identify as potentially radicalized. The idea was really to focus on the general public perception. So first, before going to where we could find roots, sources of radicalization, what is the perception of radicalization in a society? An initial very important point, when we talk about radicalization here, we just doesn't only mean jihadism or terrorist attacks by jihadists. We mean radicalization in a broad sense. I don't have the definition in front of me. If you're interested, I can read it to you after. The definition we read to the respondents. The survey was done online, so they read it. But it involves far right ideas, far left ideas, sexist ideas, xenophobia, racism, anti-Semitism. So radicalization is not only about jihadism here. It's a broad concept. So that's very important because we are not only going to limit that to this aspect. And so we asked people whether they think that this phenomenon was widespread or not in their society. At European level, we see that it's quite widespread. It's around 47% on average who said that it's a widespread phenomenon. But then if you look at country results, you see major differences between countries. And Italy, together with Greece, is among the country where there is the highest percentage share of young people who believe that radicalization is widespread. More than 50% of young people who said that radicalization is something widespread in their country. Now, when we discussed before, it was clear that in Italy, compared to other European countries, there were less terrorist attacks in the last years, so less visible phenomenon of you know, jihadist radicalization, which is maybe the most obvious one, but still, there are with France, with Greece, among the countries where the phenomenon is strongly perceived. So there is a strong phenomenon perceived among youth, and if you compare with the people aged 25-50, so the older group, there is also a difference. Older respondents in Italy are less likely to feel there is radicalization. We will see that the differences between younger and older profile of the population varied in terms of direction, but in terms of feeling radicalization being widespread, younger people are much more likely to feel this is the case. This generational gap doesn't exist in all European countries. In most countries, it's rather flat between young and older people. They feel the same. But in Greece, Spain, or Italy, countries from the south of Europe, probably also countries that share the same issues, the same social issues that are linked to the crisis and the problems of the strong social issues linked to unemployment, share the same generational divide on radicalization. And then we asked them whether they believe it will, what will be the future of radicalization. And this is rather similar in all countries, and actually similar in Italy and in other countries, maybe a bit less as strong as in other countries. But the vast majority believe that it's a phenomenon that will either spread, either remain at the same level. it's interesting because if we come back to the previous presentation, when we asked the professor about the future, he said he was surprised that there were no terrorist attacks in 2018. And this survey was done in the beginning of 2019, and people were quite pessimistic at the time. They believed that it was a strong phenomenon, and nobody really was believing that it would diminish or disappear. So this is a strong phenomenon, as we saw in Italy, and a phenomenon that is not likely to leave. It's likely to stay. It will be there, and that's the what the public opinion think. So a strong phenomenon, not likely to leave. And we asked whether people were satisfied by the actions of governments or the European Union. Remember, for Italy, it was in the middle of the national election, so probably difficult to analyze, or probably easy because we can think about the balance of the previous government. But if you see, on average, people are, let's say, divided, not as dissatisfied as we would think, with around 46% satisfied with the action of the national government, and only 42% about the action of the EU, probably also because the EU hasn't been that involved in actions against radicalization, involved in those policies. It's probably more a national or cross-border cooperation, but more a nationally action that is required in that sense. But in Italy, people are more less satisfied with the actions. Interestingly, if you compare the younger people to the older population is even less satisfied. Only 32% of people aged 25-50 are satisfied with the actions of the government against radicalization in Italy, one of the lowest level in Europe, together with Greece. And so we see that this phenomenon in public opinion and is strong, even stronger in Italy than in other countries. And now we're going to try to understand what could be the root of radicalization in the society. It's obviously a very difficult exercise because we are working on a quantitative, so general public survey. We can't be as specific. We are not dealing with an individual. We try to draw conclusions on big group of the population. So we're going to see where the fragility of the society, European society and Italian society, could be that creates this environment that is favorable to radicalization. The values. Interestingly, when we ask the values of the people or certain things, we see that they agree with the European democratic values such as peace, justice, respect for human life. They all believe it's an important values. In Italy, the most important values among all the values we tested were respect for human life. Nearly 100% of young people or older people say that. So in terms of values, despite everything we see, everything we can be seen in the media, there is a strong respect for the, at least in facade, of the democratic European values. Another interesting result, not necessarily a value, but nation. It's important for 75% of Europeans, the nation, which is, I think, believe quite strong, especially in this globalized world, or maybe it's actually a reaction to this. In Italy, it's stronger. It's 86%, the importance of nation. Italian respondents and younger ones appear to be much more patriotic than other Europeans. And when it comes to religion, religion is the least open, the least important values tested. So it's also what we see here is probably the drop of religion as a value in the society. 45% on average in Europe. But when you look at the country results, you see very strong differences. Traditional Catholic or Orthodox countries see that as much more important than in other countries, with 54% of young Italians believe that religion, and religion in general, not a specific religion, religion, is important. It's even stronger among older ones. 25-50, with 62% who said that. But when we go a bit further in the values, we ask specific questions. What we interesting to see is that we see young people in Europe, and not only in Italy, in Europe, going to more conservative values, reactionary values. I take the example of the death penalty. So a majority, and it's also the same for 25-50, believe that death penalty is the most appropriate sentence for certain crimes. The death penalty is forbidden in most countries of Europe. This is, you know, very going against what's existing, what the values, the European values, and it's a clear sign of attention, because they contradict values that have been accepted for a long time. The right to abortion is even more worrying, and it creates a generational gap that we may not have think of, with younger people more likely to say that the right to abortion should be limited to certain specific cases. Nearly half of young people. You see, on the older population, it's 41%. It's far less. So young people going for more traditional values, a lot of them saying that, and it's interesting because it's also a bit contradictory, saying that they do not have enough respect for religious values. It's very strong in Italy. But when you look at the abortion results, in Italy, it's 58% of 14 to 24 who said that they should be limited in certain specific cases. So, and it's not the case, Italy is not the only case. If you look at the other countries, which are also, which have a strong religion tradition, in Poland, in Portugal, in Ireland, in Greece, you see also this majority of young people who said that it should be limited to certain cases. And you see different results in Europe. You see that in Denmark, Austria, where results are more positive in general, I'm not talking about this question in particular, but more positive for other questions, you see a major difference. It's very ironic as well if you talk about Ireland, because I think some months after they voted to authorize abortion, but you see that young people, very high proportion, disagree with that. So there is a tension. And if you see, you come back to Italian results, you have a strong generational gap again with older people, 25-50, that in majority disagree that it should be limited to certain specific cases, that are more favorable to abortion. So there is a strong tension, and a stronger tension among young people on the values of the society. Then the satisfaction with life. And also I come back to what the professor said, that's where we see quite positive results. So we see a kind of tension in values, but if you ask them about the individual situation, young people are more positive. And they're quite satisfied with their personal life, their individual situation. They're even satisfied with their future prospects. The future is not painted in blue, usually in media, most likely in quite dark views, but they still believe that their personal future prospect is positive, with a strong majority believing that, much more than the 25-50. So it's also reiterating the fact that they are younger, more optimistic about their possibilities, because they have possibilities ahead. But interestingly, if you break down by country, you see a different situation. And in Italy, it's less the case than in Europe, than in other countries, that people are satisfied with their futures prospects. It's the lowest results with Greece in all Europe. And it's 63%. Okay, it's a majority, so still quite hopeful, but it's not as positive as in the other European countries. And there is this generational gap, which exists on, you know, overall data, but is even stronger with 25-50. Less than half of them satisfied with their prospects. Young people believe that they can succeed, that they feel part of the society, so it's rather positive. But again, on the question of you feel part of the society, Italian results are among the less positive in the survey, with 69% said that they are fully part of the society. And if you dig further with some items, and these ones are very important, you see that there is a, in Italy, compared to other countries, and it's also the case in Greece, you have a strong sense of injustice in Italian society. Around half of them say they live in a fair society, which is very similar to the average. But when we ask them whether they strongly more believe than other Europeans that there are more injustice in Italy than in other societies, and they're also far less likely to say that Italian society offers everyone opportunities for success. Only 35% of Italian people compared to 50% in average. So a social situation in Italy that is much more, much less positive than in other countries of Europe, that is much more worrying. And we have seen that one of the factors of radicalization is social discontent, social unrest. This is something happening in Italy. And when we ask about the situation of the country, and these are results that we also seen in other pan-European surveys, we see that only 21% of young people are satisfied with the situation in Italy. When you compare the results with Denmark, with Ireland, with Austria, with Germany, you see there a vast majority of people who are satisfied with the situation. So there is a strong difference between countries in that situation, and the only one that goes lower is Greece compared to the other countries. So a strong dissatisfaction with the situation of the country. And another very worrying results, and it's probably very emblematic of the results for Italy, is the satisfaction with the times they live in. Most young Europeans are satisfied with the times they live in. So that's the positive part of the survey. But when we look at the results at country level, we see that in southern countries, and especially in Italy or in Greece, and it's even worse than in Greece, only 31% of young Italians are satisfied with the times they live in. Worrying, especially when you put that into comparison with other youth, where they're actually quite satisfied with the situation, the current times. I come back on the patriotic views. They're not really satisfied with the situation of the country. It depends on the country, but in Italy they're not. But young Italians are still very proud to be European or Italian. 78% are proud to be Italian. 79% are proud to be European. So they still very much pride of their nationality, pride to be part of Europe. We see that there are some tensions with Europe at the moment between Italy and Europe, but the tension is not that they are not proud to be part of Europe, probably that they reject some of what is Europe at the moment. So on the positive part, there is a sense of pride, national or European pride. And when you look at the safety, we see that in Europe, people feel quite safe. The further you go, the less safe you feel. But for instance, in their country, most Europeans, young Europeans, feel safe, more than 75%. But again, if you look at Italy, the results are not as positive. And it's something we'll see later on. There is a sense of not feeling safe in Italy, with only 63% who feel safe in their country. We ask also the people whether they felt safer, as safe or less safe than 10 years ago. Very few Europeans feel as safe. A majority feel just as safe, and a strong minority feels less safe. But in Italy, the stronger minority is stronger, with around 40% of Italians who feel less safe than they were 10 years ago. Interestingly, you look at the results of the 25-15 Italy, it's More than half of the 2550 Italians who feel less safe than they were 10 years ago in Italy. So again, we haven't seen so many terrorist attacks in Italy, but still the feeling of the population is declining in terms of their feeling of being safe in their country. This slide, I just inserted it following the presentation earlier about the emotions. It's very important to understand, you know, because some emotions could be the source of actions. About this slide. On the positive, you see that the main emotions are joy, love, enthusiasm, hope, so very positive things associated to youth. But there are some very negative. Around 69% of young people who feel the stress, so that's in Europe, and 40% around who say they feel boredom or anger often or all the time. It's quite strong. In Italy, it's stronger. It's around half of the young Italians who feel boredom or anger at least all the time and often. The anger probably linked to the dissatisfaction with the situation, the social situation of the country. But so we see mixed feelings about the emotions of young people. Discrimination is also an issue. We asked them whether they have felt discriminated in the last 12 months. A very strong proportion of Europeans have ever felt discriminated, around 82%. We see that for various reasons, and the main reason is the physical appearance or clothing, which probably is not a strong reason, but is a reason and may be linked to other aspects. The age is an important one, the studies or the political opinions. In Italy, it's a bit stronger. The feeling of being discriminated, it's 87%. And another important thing that we discussed earlier is that the fact to know someone that has been radicalized is an important factor for radicalize yourself as well. And we see this striking figure that in Europe, around nearly a quarter of young people know someone that has been radicalized, much more than other people, 25-50, 23%. And when you look at the country results, Italy, you know, Greece being the worst, with 38% of young people knowing someone radicalized, Italy has very strong results with around 30% of young people knowing someone that has been radicalized. When you compare with other countries such as France or Belgium, where you would maybe expect a higher proportion, it's far less than in those countries. And the reasons why people are radicalized, the people they know are radicalized, are very diverse. And you see on this slide, it's not only about fundamentalist religious ideas, 25% still, but it's also about racism or xenophobic ideas, top one, 30%. Far-right political ideas, 27%. Also sexist ideas, 23%. Far-left political ideas, 21%. So we see that it's very diverse. It's not only about fundamentalist religious ideas, and in Italy, the main topic are racist ideas, far-right ideas, but also sexist ideas, very strong in Italy compared to other countries. Fundamentalist religious ideas, and a bit following the presentation we had earlier, is less strong in Italy than in other countries. Nor the media, do they trust them? Also a mixed picture. So when you look at the media consumption, you see that, it's probably something that everybody knows and everybody will think it's true, but so most young people are more likely to be on social media than traditional media. A specificity from Italy is that they are the ones where, you know, the only ones with Portugal where more than half are looking at media on traditional media every day or almost every day, more than half in Italy, which is a specificity compared to other, but very strong proportion looking at it on social media at least every day, 63%. But the trust is another story, and even if young people are more likely to receive information from social media, they are less likely to trust them compared to the traditional media. So a mismatch of what they do and how they perceive. So they are a bit skeptical about what they have on social media. But when you dig and you ask statements about the traditional media, you see that a strong proportion everywhere in Europe, and not especially in Italy, but majority everywhere in Europe, believe that the traditional media present a distorted vision of the reality. So in a way, there is no lack of trust of what the media is presenting, which creates a kind of a problem of access to the information. And on this problem of relay of information, on this problem of actors to deliver the message, to trust, there are the hate speeches that are spreading across. And we see that a very strong figure, 44% of young people in Europe are exposed on a weekly basis, at least, to violent action speeches on the internet. That's very strong. 41% about racism or xenophobia, also very strong. But when you look at the results per country, and this is one also of the highlights for Italy, is that Italy is the country where this share is the highest. You have 63% of young people, 14-24, who are exposed to violent action speeches on the internet, at least on a weekly basis. If you compare to other countries, and again you compare to Belgium and France, which are very smaller compared to Italy, you see this massive difference. This is one of the specificities of Italy, this exposure to hate speeches. That's a very worrying result we find out in our survey. And we find that as well for messages about racism, xenophobia. Here it's 60% of young people exposed to racism or xenophobic messages on a weekly basis in Italy. In Europe, it's also very strong. But again, if you see other countries, and I take the example always of France, of Belgium, where the terrorist attack happened recently, it's not as strong. Probably there is also in France actions of counter speech to counter this action. Maybe in Italy it is not the case. But that's a worrying result, because the trust in media being lower, the fact that people don't believe anymore in what is said everywhere, make those speeches probably more relevant, probably relevant to a part of the population. And with that level of exposure, it could lead to bad outcomes. Some words about the conspiracy theories. So we asked people about 9 different conspiracy theories, from very simple one like the Earth is flat, still 7% of young people believe that, to the Illuminati exist, or the 11 September attack happened differently. What we found out is a very strong proportion of people, a minority for each, but a strong proportion of people believing in those theories, around 30%. In Italy, interestingly, if you look at the results, the theory that comes very often is the Illuminati theory. I was a bit surprised to see the results. Probably you can explain me this, but there are a lot of young Italians who believe in Illuminati existence, around 40%. But Italians are not worse than other Europeans on these theories. This is spread across, and it's not specificity for Italian, not like the speeches. When you look at the results, Italy is among the lowest who get 0 correct answers, but still it's a bit similar everywhere. You have at least, you have only less than a quarter in Europe or in Italy who can give 7 to 9 correct answers to the theories we tested. Theories like, I can remind you about the Earth is flat, the Americans landed on the moon, so things that everybody here will find evident, clear. You see, among the population, you have only less than a quarter of young people able to answer correctly to 7 to 9 of them. The majority can answer correctly to 4 to 6, so sometimes only half. So we see that the lower level of trust in media, the spread of speeches, hate speeches, and the rise of conspiracy theories, fake news, however, I don't know how we can definitely call them, but this is also something, a new phenomenon. New phenomenon, a phenomenon at least. And about the democracy, do they believe in democracy? And that's also one of the worrying findings. We asked them whether they believe their country should be governed by a strong leader who does not have to worry about parliament or elections. In Europe, it's around half who believe that. But it's in five countries, including Italy, it's a majority of young people who believe this, that their country should be governed by a strong leader who doesn't have to worry about parliament. The survey was done during the national elections in Italy. So, in a way, a question on democracy by young people, they less believe so probably on the on democracy, on the way it's on the way at least politics is handled, and a worrying result. Another one is about the acceptability to limit individual freedoms under special circumstances. We see that a majority in Europe among young people believe that, 55%. In France, it's quite strong, or in Belgium as well. Probably also because they were under terrorist attack, the government had to react, and they believe that we should probably do something about, at least to protect them, and it was necessary to limit the individual freedom. But in Italy, it's also very strong, and there has not been any serious terrorist attack. So people are ready to give up their individual freedom. This is something to also think of. So they want a strong leader, and they are ready to give up some of their freedom. And do they feel violence is widespread? In their country, in Europe, yes, they feel it. 65% of Europeans, less in their private environment, although, in the place where they live, 22% of young people think it's frequent violence, or at home as well. 11% feel it's widespread. It's 1 out of 10 young people. So I wouldn't diminish this, but I would say a perception that violence is present. It's quite strong. And in Italy, again, very, you know, you have strong differences per country. In Italy, it's 80% of young people who said that violence is frequent in their country. Same level as Greece. Again, the two countries share very similar results, but very different from other countries, from Austria, from Denmark. So again, and we saw earlier that they feel less safe, a sentiment of violence. Do they think it's acceptable? Yes and yes, in a way they would accept the use of violence, mostly under extreme circumstances, but still the use of violence is to a certain degree acceptable. And finally, in which circumstances they would be ready to use violence? The main answer, we tested several items. Italy is, you know, among the lowest one on this one, but still quite high. You have a very strong proportion of people who believe that they would be ready to use violence to defend friends or families. So in conclusion, it's something that, I mean, I would like we can discuss. Obviously, violent radicalization is a strong phenomenon, and is a stronger phenomenon in Italy, at least perceived. Young people are satisfied in Europe about their life, but in Italy, less so. And there is a strong dissatisfaction with the situation of the country, and a feeling that they are not satisfied with the times they live in, which is not the case in other countries, not the case in most of the countries. This goes with a strong feeling of injustice. I think social unrest is a phenomenon in Italy that may lead to actions, radicalized actions, so something to worry about. And they're also among the countries where violence is the most widespread, and that they don't feel safe. The exposure to hate speech or speech about violent action, racism, xenophobia, antisemitism is very strong in Italy, much stronger than in European countries. So something maybe to act on, to develop a counter speech, maybe something something to do about this to avoid this to spread. And finally, young Italians, as other Europeans, but in a stronger way, are leaning to conservative values and questioning the current democratic system. So there is a feeling that young people are exposed to radicalization in Europe, but maybe a bit more in Italy than in other countries. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Nicolas. And I think that I am quite worried about some of these results. My feeling is to be worried and to think on. I think that we need to think, to go deeper in this data, to try to discuss also in other context, national context, to think on more deep. Do you have some question? Otherwise, we can go on with the meeting, and I ask so to the people involved in the project to manage this session. I propose a change, since we are a little bit later. Perhaps it's possible to postpone the intervention that Arancha Motta should do, and now Ruth should have. And now, so we go in the, we can leave the Serafin Alava intervention and Rasha Nagem intervention, if you agree. Okay, thank you. Okay, for tomorrow. So Serafin.
Je vais essayer de rester debout. J'ai vu que Nicolas l'avait très bien fait. Mon intervention va être plutôt une intervention réflexive, même si je présenterai les différents états des lieux de nos projets. Je vais d'abord faire un temps réflexif, c'est-à-dire que nous sommes dans notre projet à mi-parcours. À mi-parcours, il est de bon ton de réfléchir. Beaucoup de choses ont changé depuis que nous avons commencé notre projet. J'ai écouté Lorenzo Vidino et il parlait de combattants étrangers, combattants qui partaient. On sait que dans la plupart des pays européens, il y en a de moins en moins, même s'ils partent sur d'autres terrains de guerre, mais il y en a de moins en moins. Mais la radicalisation n'est pas terminée. Donc on voit bien que le paysage en un an et demi a beaucoup changé, et qu'il faut, dans notre projet, prendre en compte ces évolutions. Il y a aussi, on le perçoit en Europe, quand les attentats se font un peu plus loin, l'idée de dire, mais finalement, est-ce qu'on pourrait se passer de travailler à la prévention de la radicalisation? Est-ce que tout ça ne serait pas quelque chose de peut-être inutile ou futile. Dans notre projet, on avait comme objectif d'abord d'expliquer et de comprendre les processus de radicalisation avec une vision pluridisciplinaire et holistique. Notre projet, on a répondu à un appel d'offres qui précisait cela. À partir de ce mi-parcours, nous avons apporté, on le verra, un certain nombre de réponses à la compréhension de ce que sont les processus de radicalisation, à la compréhension en quoi portent-ils à des aspects pluridisciplinaires. Et je pense que l'ensemble de la recherche dans le monde a aujourd'hui à peu près résolu à ces questions. Est-ce qu'on a résolu aux questions politiques qui se posent derrière cette partie-là? Peut-être pas. Et il y a, j'ai pris Mafalda pour pouvoir le dire, situations dans lesquelles on préférerait ne pas entendre, on préférerait ne pas voir, on préférerait ne pas avoir à parler sur ces questions-là. Je vais citer quelques problèmes qui me semblent, moi, être importants et qui sont au cœur de notre réflexion. D'accord ? On a parlé au moment de radicalisation que la radicalisation n'était pas seulement quelque chose qui venait de quartiers défavorisés, de quartiers populaires. Et je remercie l'intervenant tout à l'heure d'avoir précisé que des personnes radicalisées n'étaient pas obligatoirement des personnes d'origine étrangère étant dans les quartiers. Mais il existe bien moins une réalité concrète qui est que dans certaines zones, les discours complotistes se développent, les discours de soutien passif ou actif à des organismes terroristes existent et qu'il faudra bien l'aborder. Ouais. En même temps, on a eu très vite tendance à dire on va parler de radicalisation, puis après on va parler de radicalisation djihadiste, et puis finalement c'est la radicalisation des musulmans. Ouais. Et ne voir que dans la radicalisation ce point. On a vu Nicolas qui, dans son enquête, montre bien qu'il y a d'autres peurs et d'inquiétudes de radicalisation. La radicalisation d'extrême droite, des radicalisations d'extrême gauche, des radicalisations sociales, et on voit bien qu'elles existent. Et pour connaître les services de sécurité de la France, on voit bien qu'il y a du travail à faire pour suivre aussi ces radicalisations. Est-ce qu'on va rester à cette idée qu'il n'y a qu'une radicalisation religieuse, ou est-ce qu'on va ouvrir la réflexion pour voir les autres radicalisations qui sont aussi menaçantes que d'autres? Ça, on pourra se le poser. En même temps, on luttait contre le fait que des jeunes, par erreur ou par engagement, partent sur des terrains de guerre. On l'a même, dans beaucoup de pays européens, pénalisé. L'intention de partir sur un terrain de guerre était un acte qui était un acte non légal et qui relevait de la loi. Mais maintenant qu'ils ne partent plus, maintenant qu'ils ne sont plus à l'étranger, comment va-t-on conduire nos politiques de ville? Comment va-t-on structurer notre forme du vivre ensemble, sachant qu'il y a au sein même de notre cité ces problèmes qui existent? Et nous avons choisi, dans le projet Practicis, de travailler avec un forum de villes et de travailler avec des villes. Pour cette question, on ne la cache pas. Que dès qu'il n'y a plus d'attentats ou moins d'attentats, dès qu'on n'a plus repéré, on recommence comme avant et on continue nos politiques de ville comme avant. Hein? Cette question reste toujours posée. On a beaucoup parlé de radicalisation et de processus de radicalisation. Mais on sait qu'aujourd'hui, que les processus de radicalisation commencent par des idées radicales, des opinions radicales, qui, elles, ne sont pas passibles de la loi. Je peux, dans ma tête intérieure, penser que, sincèrement, je suis de la race blanche et que je suis le meilleur au monde. Tant que je ne l'exprime pas dans l'espace public, je ne suis pas passible de la loi. Mais est-ce qu'on va se cacher les yeux et est-ce qu'on ne va pas se poser comme problème que l'éducation, dans sa démarche de prévention, doit aller jusqu'à cette idée qui émerge dans le cerveau d'un jeune et qui va progressivement construire un « eux » et un « nous » qui sera la source de radicalisation. Et dans les politiques de contre-discours, on voit bien que l'on va plus à l'avant. On essaie de mettre en place des actions qui préviennent les phénomènes violents, pas seulement en augmentant les systèmes de sécurité et le nombre de policiers et le nombre d'agents du renseignement, mais en allant dans la culture, dans l'éducation, travailler avec les jeunes pour faire que ça n'arrive pas. Là aussi, est-ce qu'on va se cacher les yeux et est-ce qu'on va se dire « non, c'est pas utile ». N'investissons pas dans des centres culturels, n'investissons pas dans la culture, n'investissons pas dans l'enseignement. Après tout, il nous suffira de surveiller que ces jeunes ne passent pas à l'acte. Toutes ces questions-là, elles étaient au début, mais elles me semblent aujourd'hui plus actives et plus importantes par rapport à ça. Dans notre projet, nous sommes 22 partenaires et de plusieurs pays, et c'est une grosse machine que nous avons mis en place, et il nous faudra aussi faire un peu le point, le bilan de notre activité collective. J'avais dit au premier meeting Que je ne serais pas un chef de file qui serait un dictateur éclairé et que le tais-toi et rame, ce n'était pas moi. Et on peut faire le bilan de notre façon de fonctionner ensemble, qui a été parfois complexe, d'autres fois très autonome. Mais je suis heureux de penser que quand on laisse l'autonomie aux gens, ils s'en emparent et ils font des choses. Et que je n'ai pas la prétention de savoir tout ce qui se fait à l'intérieur du projet Praxis 6. Même si je disais ça à un membre de la Commission européenne, il serait fort étonné. Hein? Donc les groupes se sont mis en place. Hein, on a 9 World Packages, des activités qui sont mises en place, des groupes autonomes qui travaillent et qui, au fur et à mesure de l'action, se posent peut-être des questions sur ben, finalement l'utilité. Parce que quand on est dans le faire, on se pose la question de l'utilité. On va les passer en liste et on va regarder en quoi sont-ils utiles aujourd'hui et où ils en sont. En même temps, comme toute personne qui travaille, on est un peu dans le burn-out. Et on est un peu pressé par des aspects administratifs. Nous sommes dans un mi-parcours. Nous allons devoir rendre des livrables à la Commission européenne. Des experts vont venir valider nos projets, nous interroger là-dessus. Et nous devons être des bons élèves. Il ne faut pas râler et il nous faudra rendre notre copie autant. Pourquoi ? Pour une simple question de citoyenneté. L'argent que nous avons reçu ne nous appartient pas, elle appartient à l'ensemble des citoyens européens, donc nous devons aux citoyens européens de faire le travail pour quoi on a été payé et de le rendre dans les meilleurs temps possibles. Une conduite de projet, c'est lié toujours à ces phases-là. Dans le départ, on a de l'euphorie, on est content, puis finalement on s'inquiète, et puis finalement on se dit on ne va jamais y arriver, ça, on ne va pas y arriver. C'est pas possible. Et puis après, on se dit, mais c'est la causa. Ouais. La cause des coupables. Et bien sûr, on finit par punir les innocents. Et enfin, on se demande, mais pourquoi je suis venu dans un projet pareil ? On est loin de cette situation. On est à mi-parcours et le bilan qu'on va présenter sur les projets me semble moins intéressant, fort riche, fort intéressant. Et le travail que fera Racha tout à l'heure pour présenter un peu nos démarches de communication institutionnelle et notre travail institutionnel montrera que nous avons su prendre notre place dans l'ensemble des projets européens qui travaillent dans ce domaine-là. On n'est pas seul, il y en a plusieurs autres et qui font du travail de qualité, mais on a su prendre notre place. Et le travail que l'on fait, sur 60 livrables, nous allons rendre une trentaine de livrables. Dans ces trentaines de livrables, il y a, et on va les passer, des choses très importantes, me semble-t-il, en termes de qualité. Reste à nous à pouvoir le valoriser et à pouvoir le faire avancer. Je ne vais dire que deux mots sur le travail qu'a fait Kantar et Avenou. Sur ce travail d'enquête, quasiment de travail unique en Europe, qui nous permet d'avoir un panel très large, représentatif de la population, et comme l'a fait Nicolas, qui est plein de questionnements, de problèmes, qu'il nous faut décortiquer. Il nous faut les décortiquer au niveau européen, mais il faut le décortiquer au niveau de chaque pays. Il a éclairé l'Italie. Ce qui était normal, on pourrait se poser la question du Portugal, on pourrait se poser la question de l'Espagne, d'autres éléments. Il serait idiot d'avoir fait ce travail et dire on a rendu notre travail, on ne s'en occupe plus. Donc la seconde phase va être la phase d'exploitation. Il faut que chacun se sente capable avec d'autres d'étudier ces statistiques et bien sûr Kantar nous donne accès à la source totale de ces statistiques pour les analyser et pour les compléter. Nous proposons la démarche suivante. Quand nous allons travailler sur des démarches européennes, nous ferons un appel à candidature pour tous ceux qui veulent et on formera un groupe européen. Mais si Marcus en Autriche veut travailler sur les fichiers et regarder en Autriche, eh bien il a accès libre à cela. Il a la possibilité de travailler et de regarder sur l'Autriche avec d'autres collègues, même s'ils ne sont pas de notre projet. Il a le droit d'aller chercher le spécialiste de l'Autriche avec lui pour dire « Tiens, il y a un problème là. Comment on pourrait répondre à cette question-là » Chaque partenaire d'un pays, en relation avec les autres partenaires du pays, a l'autonomie de pouvoir prendre ces données, de les réfléchir et de les travailler. Bien sûr, comme nous sommes en lien avec des villes, il est intéressant que ce travail se fasse aussi avec les équipes des villes, qu'elles aient l'occasion de réfléchir. Elles ont été au début un petit peu gênées du fait que notre enquête ne portait pas sur les villes. Elle porte sur les pays. Mais il y a sûrement des enseignements à prendre et des enseignements à faire. Ce travail-là va commencer dès demain. Dès demain, des groupes par pays, animés par les pays ou au niveau européen, vont porter. Je vous prends un cas, mais comme je n'étais pas là durant toute l'intervention de Nicolas, peut-être il a abordé. Si on regarde les pays du sud de l'Europe, ils ne répondent pas pareil que les pays du nord de l'Europe. Pourquoi ? Est-ce à dire que les pays du sud sont une pression migratoire ? Est-ce que c'est ça qui donne l'explication ? Est-ce que non, ce sont des pays dont le développement économique a quelques problèmes ces temps-ci ? Non. Est-ce que c'est les modalités de gestion en termes de sécurité publique, nationaux, autonomie, région ? Plein de questions. On a la question, on n'a pas la réponse. Il nous faudra peut-être aller regarder d'autres collègues qui ont ces réponses-là. Et donc, j'invite à ce travail-là, et je crois qu'on va pouvoir rendre à la communauté européenne une enquête solide, sérieuse, analysée, et un potentiel dans les années qui viennent d'articles scientifiques qui vont préciser ce travail et qui vont l'améliorer. On avait demandé à l'équipe de Bouzard de nous aider à faire une étiologie des processus de radicalisation. Je le rentrerai en détail tout à l'heure. Après le travail, je rappelle, sur, si je ne me trompe pas, 350 cas analysés, un travail statistique quantitatif et un travail qualitatif autour de l'ensemble des données, on a aujourd'hui une vision assez claire là-dessus. Hein ? Et qu'est-ce que j'en retiens ? Quand Lorenzo a parlé, je m'étais dit, tiens, il est en train de dire tout ce que je vais dire et je vais le faire que répéter. Oui, il n'y a pas qu'un seul profil de radicalisation. Oui, la façon de rentrer dans la radicalisation est différente. Il peut y avoir qui rentrent de façon émotive. Il y a des personnes qui peuvent y rentrer de façon politique. Il y a des personnes qui peuvent rentrer de façon embrigadée, par emprise. Il y a des différences. Alors, est-ce que nos dispositifs d'observation, de surveillance s'adaptent à ces différences ? Je vous prends un cas que Dounia n'a pas explicité, mais qui est réel. Puisque nous savons que certains vont se déclencher sur des éléments de contexte personnel, des choses affectives, et qui vont passer à l'acte là-dessus, qui est le mieux placé pour pouvoir le détecter ? Les personnes au niveau le plus local possible ou les personnes au niveau national le plus grand possible ? Donc, la question de la relation entre les polices municipales et les polices nationales est renforcée, parce que c'est là qu'on voit que la personne ne va pas bien. C'est là qu'on perçoit les premiers signes. Et donc, du coup, on voit bien que ça va avoir une influence sur notre conception, et c'est le World Package 5, de l'organisation des politiques de sécurité. Et ça, je crois que c'est important. On voit que le débat qui était celui au début de notre projet entre ceux qui pensaient que la cause, c'était une idéologie religieuse salafiste et ceux qui pensaient que c'était une misère sociale qui se combattait, hein, eh bien, il est résolu. C'est ceci et ceci en même temps. C'est des variables qui interviennent en interaction avec des niveaux différents. Donc on ne peut pas avoir une pensée qui serait une pensée linéaire. Il faut qu'on construise une pensée complexe. Bien sûr, il y a des phénomènes de misère sociale, mais aussi il y a des phénomènes de diffusion d'idées radicales violentes. En même temps, il y a des phénomènes psychologiques. Dounia le montre bien en montrant le passé et les origines de ces familles, en montrant aussi que dans certains cas, on a des problèmes de maltraitance dans l'enfance. Il y a l'ensemble. Donc, on ne pourra pas résoudre en ouvrant dans un pays le grand centre de psychologie intégrale, ni dans un autre le grand centre de sociologie intégrale. Il nous faudra travailler ensemble, il nous faudra travailler à mélanger nos savoir-faire, pour que nous puissions mieux comprendre ces phénomènes complexes. Chaque fois, je ne voulais pas montrer, vous l'avez vu, hein, le niveau de réalisation du travail. On est passé là du 80% au 100%. Nous avions voulu, dès le début, montrer que comme nous ne nous préoccupons pas seulement de sécurité, malgré que nous étions dans un domaine H2020 sécurité, et que nous nous préoccupions de comment construire des outils pour éduquer et pour travailler à l'éducation dans cette partie-là, on a le Road Pachachas Citizen Agora, qui a démarré, qui a déjà structuré la réflexion et les outils, et qui attend beaucoup des villes, qui attend que les villes s'emparent de ces projets pour les réaliser. Parce que nous avons posé le défi de vérifier nous-mêmes que ce que nous produisons marche. C'est le défi de notre projet, c'est réaliser des outils et le vérifier au sein de villes. Et donc, grâce, on le verra à la fin, au travail de l'EFUS de mobilisation des villes, mais aussi grâce à notre effort à tous, chaque fois qu'on rencontre une ville qui est partenaire, en disant « faut répondre, faut y aller hein ». C'est important, on a avancé dans ce cadre-là. Sur ce projet-là, ce road package et le prochain, comme le prochain meeting aura lieu à Toulouse dans le cadre du Forum des villes éducatives, nous ferons une focale sur ces outils pédagogiques et nous montrerons à la fois comment ils ont commencé à être évalués et quelles sont leurs spécificités. Véronique Delenner qui est là, à partir de son expérience sur le net, on a beaucoup parlé de ça, hein. L'Internet, elle avait déjà développé, elle continue à développer l'idée que en faisant participer les jeunes à l'Internet, en leur faisant agir à travers le projet Digital Me, on peut avancer. Hein. Est-ce que ça a un impact? Est-ce qu'on le fait? Et est-ce que ça a un impact réel sur la réduction des violences? Est-ce que ça a un impact direct sur le sentiment de sécurité des personnes? Ce sont des choses que nous devons vérifier. On est dans la première phase, celle du travail, de réalisation, mais il nous faudra mesurer les impacts pour montrer comment ça fonctionne. Dans le travail qui est réalisé dans le Road Pachachas 6, tout le travail de conception, alors ils reviendront demain là-dessus, de réflexion, est bien entamé. Et on voit la perspective rapide de l'outil. Il nous faut maintenant trouver des structures qui vont l'utiliser, le vérifier. Vérifier que les hypothèses du groupe sont des hypothèses pertinentes et faire cet aller-retour. Ça touche à quelque chose qui est l'éducation aux médias. Et on le voit bien que dans la question du processus de radicalisation, il y a des processus de communication et d'information. On voit bien qu'il n'existe pas de radicalisation solitaire seule, qu'il existe des relations avec des autres qui viennent parler avec vous, et à travers des informations que l'on va chercher, interpréter, avec un niveau de maîtrise de ces outils et de ces informations différents. Il nous faut donc faire un travail d'éducation aux médias, et il nous faut aussi faire un travail citoyen pour décortiquer ces fausses informations et ces discours et théories du complot qui viennent tordre les éléments. Pourquoi ? C'est pour donner aux jeunes la capacité de développer son propre esprit critique et de ne pas se faire avoir par un esprit critique. Ça portera autant bien sur des journaux qui sont très vendus et très repris que des sites complotistes. Former le jeune à avoir une opinion est un point important. On voit bien que là, on est aussi à mi-parcours du travail et qu'il va falloir ensemble de travailler à diffuser cet outil-là et aussi l'évaluer. Dans notre projet, on a souhaité que les villes participent à une mise en commun, un regard croisé des différents éléments de politique, qu'on avance. Des enquêtes ont été lancées. Des rencontres ont été faites avec les différentes municipalités. Il manque encore quelques villes qui ne nous aident pas et qui sont encore en attente. Je sais, on est très occupé dans les villes et surtout quand on va parler des problèmes de sécurité. Mais je crois que c'est important de mélanger cela et de faire que chacun, par le partage des idées, puisse voir les bonnes pratiques et améliorer ces pratiques-là. On avait fait le pari, qui est un pari que nous tiendrons, et peut-être de façon critique, que nous pouvions savoir quel était un discours radical. En quoi les mots et le langage de la radicalisation étaient importants. Et chaque jour, nous le voyons. Hein, le mot radicalisation, radicalité, terrorisme, sont des mots qui sont des mots piégés dès le départ. Quand nous voulons convaincre, il nous faut trouver les mots qui sont partés. On sait très bien que dans ces discours, la question des discours d'émotion, de témoignage, d'argumentation sont très forts. Et le groupe qui travaille là-dessus, vous voyez, est à 70%, c'est-à-dire que le travail de recherche a été quasiment fait, qu'on a la masse, que les résultats sont là, mais qu'il nous faut maintenant le diffuser. Parce qu'il doit être utilisable et ça doit utiliser cela. Hein. Et je crois que c'est important que chacun s'empare de cela, sinon nous sommes toujours un peu en décalage. Hein. En décalage avec les jeunes et avec l'activité. Je ne veux prendre comme exemple que pendant la pause, malgré que j'avais envie de boire un café, j'ai dû appeler une structure de pénitentiaire qui reçoit des jeunes en situation de placement judiciaire et qui me demandait d'intervenir sur la radicalisation. Et je leur dis, je vous préviens, je n'utiliserai jamais le mot radicalisation. Je vais utiliser le mot violence. Je vais utiliser le mot infraction. Mais je n'utiliserai pas le mot radicalisation. Il n'est pas possible de le tenir avec des jeunes. Oui, mais il se parle beaucoup de théorie du complot. Je n'utiliserai pas théorie du complot. J'utiliserai d'autres mots. Je vais essayer de m'adapter pour que les mots que je parle soient audibles, qu'ils ne soient pas rejetés par les jeunes. Il nous faut bien comprendre ce problème linguistique pour pouvoir poser des contre-discours. Sinon, on fait comme le fait notre ministère, je peux me le permettre parce que je sors d'une enquête sur l'efficacité du site Stop Djihadisme. On met stop djihadisme, ça y est, ça ne marche pas, c'est terminé. On a pris deux mots qui immédiatement sont mal interprétés et qui ne fonctionnent pas. Et en plus, on le met sur le site du ministère de l'Intérieur. Alors là, le jour où un radicalisé ira sur le site du ministère de l'Intérieur pour prendre quelque chose qui va le convaincre qu'il s'est trompé, il faudra me le présenter. Voilà. Donc je crois que ça, c'est important. Nous avons choisi aussi de travailler du côté technologique, d'aborder les outils technologiques, de produire des outils, pas des grands outils, des grosses machineries, genre Big Brother, qui nous dirait précisément telle personne qui vient de se connecter, voilà ce qu'elle pense, mais des outils qui peuvent aider les professionnels. On travaille, et toutes les politiques aujourd'hui européennes sur la question de l'Internet disent il faut enlever la référence, il faut déréférencer le site. Et veulent interdire à Google de mettre des références. Ok, on sait que la plupart des processus se passent dans un échange à l'intérieur d'un réseau social. Quels sont les outils que l'on a là-dessus? Quels sont les outils pour caractériser rapidement un site radical? Par quelle base on va le faire? Il y a un gros travail technologique qui est mené partout dans le monde. Nous avons choisi d'y prendre notre part. Et vous voyez, au niveau de la conception de l'ingénierie, on est à 65%. On a des éléments, on a des apports. Il nous faut maintenant les vérifier, les valider et en faire la démonstration pour pouvoir avancer. Donc, on a encore du travail. Enfin, on a choisi, et c'est notre spécificité, de travailler avec des villes. On a travaillé avec des villes et assez vite, je pense que c'est au congrès ou au colloque de l'EFUS à Barcelone, on a choisi de laisser des villes s'associer à nous. Et on a d'autres villes qui se sont associées à nous et qui ont avancé. Et on a choisi avec l'EFUS qu'un groupe mené par le forum de sécurité urbaine, animant les villes, fasse cette promotion. Parce qu'il nous semble très important que ça dissémine et qu'on ne fera rentrer nos idées dans les villes que quand on fera participer les plus hauts niveaux des villes, les plus hauts niveaux politiques. Hein? Et donc, il nous fallait un outil, un partenaire qui fasse ce travail-là. Ce travail-là est fait, il est à 45%, on a encore du travail, on a encore d'autres meetings pour pouvoir faire avancer, mais ça commence à être diffusé. En tout cas, c'est reconnu par l'Union européenne, puisque chaque fois qu'il y a des questions autour des pouvoirs locaux et de la sécurité, nous sommes invités. Et on pense à nous et qu'on nous demande. Et que sur ces questions-là, on est reconnu. Voilà à peu près pour le travail. On est à mi-parcours. On n'a pas à être inquiet, mais il faut qu'on soit sérieux. Je voudrais faire une focale parce que Dunia Bouza ne pouvait pas être là sur son travail. Rappeler des choses qui ont déjà été présentées à Bruxelles, mais je vais le cibler sur des choses qui me semblent moins importantes pour qu'on ne refasse plus des erreurs. Dunia, dans l'analyse de son processus de radicalisation, nous parle d'une approche émotionnelle, d'une approche collective, d'une approche relationnelle, d'une approche idéologique. En nous disant cela, quand elle analyse des cas, il faut nous dire est-ce que nos politiques, est-ce que nos actions prennent bien en compte cela, hein? Je peux le dire d'autant plus que c'est au cours d'une journée à Madrid que j'ai pu le découvrir. Comment prend-on en compte la dimension relationnelle? Est-ce qu'on n'est pas en train de travailler que sur les individus comme s'ils étaient isolés, qu'on ne travaille pas sur les groupes, qu'on ne regarde pas les dynamiques de groupe, qu'on ne se pose pas les questions d'identité de groupe et qu'on n'avance pas là-dessus? Comment nos activités vont prendre en compte ces groupes-là? On parle de la partie émotionnelle. Est-ce que nos contre-discours ont une charge émotionnelle? Et cette charge émotionnelle est-elle efficace? En terminant une enquête pour le ministère auprès de jeunes, quand on leur pose la question, après avoir vu plusieurs contre-discours, quel est ce qui t'ont le plus fait réfléchir? Quasiment à 70%, les témoignages. Le témoignage. Que des gens qui sont vraiment ont vécu ça ou qui sont viennent parler. Comment fait-on pour structurer nos éléments par une relation avec des personnes qui peuvent témoigner? Comment structure-t-on nos idées? D'accord? Il y a encore des travaux à faire au niveau psychologique, psychosocial, psychocognitif, pour réfléchir à ces problèmes-là et comprendre, essayer de mieux comprendre le basculement. Donc, après le travail qu'a fait Dunia Bouzard, qui, elle, est comme le travail de Kantar, il n'est pas dans une armoire et il n'est pas le fait. Les outils sont à disposition, les livrables sont publics, on va pouvoir s'en emparer pour aller sur ces modèles-là comparer. Quand on regarde les facteurs qu'elle a mis, les facteurs sociaux, et quand on regarde l'implication, et quand elle montre sur ces publics-là que, certes, il y a des personnes qui sont de classe populaire, mais il y a de la classe moyenne, et il y a des différentes façons d'entrer, qu'on ne peut pas résumer ça, c'est une question juste de pauvreté ou de discrimination. On est obligé de constituer notre vision des mécanismes de risque et des facteurs de risque différemment. Et quand elle aborde les pôles d'attractivité qui font qu'un jeune va pouvoir basculer, l'aide humanitaire, sauver la famille, la toute-puissance, le scénario pour mourir, et ainsi de suite, elle nous dit des idéologies qui nous indiquent que le jeune va plutôt basculer là-dessus. Et nous, dans nos discours républicains, dans nos discours de prévention, est-ce qu'on est porteur d'idées, d'entrain, d'idées qui nous dépassent? Comment fait-on valoriser le fait que on peut arriver à convaincre l'autre par les mots et pas en le frappant, et que le convaincre avec les mots, c'est quand même quasiment beaucoup plus héroïque et beaucoup plus solide que le convaincre par des coups? Comment porte-t-on, nous, un contre-discours d'existence pour montrer que d'être un citoyen, c'est pas d'être un petit lambda nul, c'est être quelqu'un qui a un beau pouvoir et une belle place dans la société. Sinon, ces grandes idées, ces idées qui emportent les foules seront toujours du côté des bad boys, toujours du côté du négatif. Sincèrement, dans certaines banlieues à Toulouse, vaut mieux être Scarface qu'être Macron. C'est vachement plus intéressant l'un et l'autre. Hein, les deux ont à peu près réussi et les deux font à peu près la même chose. Donc, mais oui, je crois que c'est important de pouvoir le dire. Réfléchir aux facteurs de désistance. On ne parle plus de déradicalisation, on parle de désistance. C'est-à-dire comment on renonce à ce travail-là. Comment on le fait? On a dans le World Patient Sec autour... du travail autour des prisons, un travail qui est fait. On sait qu'il va falloir identifier des facteurs de désistance, les repérer et les valoriser. Parfois, les questions seront bien sociales, seront bien l'emploi. Hein? Si on n'a rien à faire, on n'a rien à perdre. Mais parfois, ça ne suffit pas. Parce qu'on peut avoir un emploi et être toujours dans la même idéologie et dans les mêmes idées de rupture. Donc il va nous falloir non pas inventer une méthode miraculeuse de déradicalisation, mais observer cas par cas comment les personnes sortent de cette radicalisation et comment on peut les y aider. Vous voyez, dans l'ensemble, on est à mi-parcours, on a bien avancé. Je pense qu'on est... aujourd'hui reconnu, on est débordé, on est au bord du burn-out. Hein? C'est à peu près normal, on est à la moitié du parcours. Hein, je ne veux pas faire celui qui vous vend les miracles, mais vous, sincèrement, dans 6 mois, vous voyez le printemps, et dans 8 mois, on aura quasiment tout fait, et on sera fier d'avoir tout fait, et on se dira, chouette, je repars dans un autre projet. Hein? Donc on est dans la mauvaise phase. Hein, où on va vous tarabuster, Louis et Racha, pour tel document, tel élément, pour rendre tel élément, parce qu'il nous faut être républicains, il nous faut rendre des comptes à l'Union européenne, parce que nous respectons ce fait qu'on prend de l'argent aux individus au nom d'une société, donc nous n'avons pas à être des fainéants, il nous faut travailler. Mais en même temps, on rend des choses qui sont des choses utiles, intéressantes. On rend des choses qui sont pertinentes. À nous de les travailler après et à nous aussi de les diffuser dès qu'ils sont validés pour que d'autres puissent s'entendre. On connaît à peu près les 6 projets qui existent, qui travaillent sur la radicalisation. On est en interaction avec eux. On a fait un séminaire en commun avec... avec 3 des projets, on a d'autres perspectives. Je pense qu'on a aujourd'hui, à ce mi-parcours, à ne pas trembler et à faire un pas en avant, c'est-à-dire à continuer notre route. Merci.
Now, Russia will present stakeholder engagement and dissemination. Russia Nagel.
So thank you, Angela, for this organization, and thank you for all the participants and our partners. We are tired, I think, so my part would be light. No, nothing scientific, but I talk about our meetings and what we did since 1 year. So we'll start with the institutional meeting. So as you see, I will start in after the kickoff meeting in Madrid. We participated in the Nice conference. It's the mayors of European and Mediterranean cities facing the challenge of terrorism. It was organized by in the Mediterranean University Center of Nice. And the conference was organized by the city of Nice, the Metropole, Euromed, EFUS, as practices we participated also. So what was the results of the conference? I think you all have this, the Nice declaration. If you have it, you can have the declaration outside. And Serafin Alava, Professor Serafin Alava, participated in a roundtable about how to prevent youth radicalization. And Dunia Bozar also made a presentation in the framework of Work Package 3. Then we participated in the EFUS International Conference that was made in Barcelona, Security, Democracy and Cities, Co-producing Urban Cities. Okay, like this. Okay. And we, as we say, it's the with the government of Catalonia and the city of Barcelona. It was organized by EFUS. The participants in general in this conference discussed about contemporary challenges like the prevention of violent radicalization and urban security in the planning of public spaces. This is the main theme. So the University of Rey Juan Carlos, they presented the Association of Cities to the program and the main ideas that support the work to be delivered by the university. And practices, we made a presentation of our project in this meeting. Then we go to the month of January, and practices participated in the Forum for the Prevention of Radicalization, Youth and the Heart of Social Transformation and the Prevention of Violence in Beirut, Lebanon. So we went to tell there to present practices, so it's not only in Europe. And in March 2018, we participated in the EU Mayors Conference, Building Urban Defenses Against Terrorism, Lesson Learned from Recent Attacks at the Committee of the Region in Belgium. And the Committee of the Region is the institution of the European Union that represents and unites its regional and local authorities. The main ideas that were put forward during the conference is how to protect citizens in public spaces. Okay, there's a need for cooperation at all levels of governance, like local, regional, national, and EU-wide. The second point of this conference was the local authority must play an active and crucial role to make cities safer for the citizens. So representatives of cities from the European Union were invited to join the common effort to address terrorism and radicalization. And the third point was there's a need to count with private efforts in this goal. Private actors should be included also to face terrorism. And another point is the EU mayors presented the covenant on the protection of public spaces and counter radicalization. This is, in general, our institutional meeting. Then our activities. So today I will talk about the main meetings, but we did a lot, but we cannot say all today. Our activities at the European Parliament. So we have made many activities on the months of October, December 2017 and January 2018. In October 2017, there was this meeting with French deputy. So you had Nathalie Grisbeck, Eva Joly, Madame Rachida Dati. And in December 2017, we have meeting with Spanish deputy. So excuse me for the name. So, Maite Pakanam, you can say it? Sorry, I don't want to destroy the thing. Maite Pakasatunda, Augustin Diaz de Mera, Beatriz Becerra, Teresa Jimenez Peccini, Elena Valenciano Espejo. That's it? Okay. So the objective of the mission in this visits was the presentation of practices to the member of the European Parliament, provide member of European Parliament with updated insights of radicalization leading to violence from academic and practical point of view, underlining the relevance of supporting local political structure, obtain their vision to make the research available to the political actors in the best possible way, support common frameworks to prevent the spread and growth of violent extremism, develop common toolkits and common policies on security. Ruth, do you want to add something about these meetings? No, it's okay. Okay. Then we have in Jan 2008, these meetings provided us with the understanding to organize what we call on the 24th of January an open session, practices at the heart of the European practices at the European Parliament, and this, and we called it the city at the heart of prevention of violent radicalization. And here the program that we presented was the practices presentation. And the project coordinator, he gave a presentation called The City at the Heart of the Prevention of Radicalization. Then the question about how should we design and implement prevention policies in the city, the relevance of research was presented by Professor Ruth Bermejo. Then, in the same way, we talked also about what role should played by the European Parliament and the rest of EU institution, the city a relevant actor, and this was by the deputy, Mrs. Beatrice Becerra. She's a member of the European Parliament, and she's the vice chair of the subcommittee of human rights, and members of the Committee of Development and Humanitarian Aid, and all this. Then the fourth point, we're responding to the challenge of radicalization in the city when cities innovate the prevention. And this was done by Mr. Julio Andrade, Vice Mayor of the City of Malaga. And he was talking about the cross-cutting plan for conviviality and prevention of violent radicalization in the city of Malaga. So this is our European meeting, and in between we had a lot of meetings. For instance, we met the for the European meeting, but we met the Serafin was had an edition in the Senat, French Senat. We had, for instance, a meeting with Luis with the Minister of Interior, Belgian Minister of Interior. So we have this face-to-face meeting with one or two responsible in the government, but I will not mention all of them today. So then we had our internal meetings. So the internal meetings, we started, for instance, in September 2017, when we have a big meeting like today. Today is a string. We have like the meeting of Nice. If we can make an internal meeting with our partner in Nice, we take this into consideration, this occasion, and we do it. And for instance, in Nice, we had an internal meeting of the WP5, okay, which is the policies to fight against radicalization, overcoming implementation problem. So the objective of the work package 5 is to describe and analyze current policies and strategy to counter extremism in European countries at a national level. This is the objective. And we had another meeting when we were in Barcelona. In this meeting, there was CITCO, the University of Fray Juan Carlos, and University of Toulouse. And we made we had a meeting in the office of the Ministry of Interior. That's it, in Spain. So it was a meeting, consider it as an internal meeting. Then in March 2018, we had a meeting made by the Work Package 4 in Salzburg and Work Package 8. The Work Package 4 is early prevention and inclusive citizenship education, and the Work Package 8 is the EFIS Work Package, Working Group of City and Dissemination. And it was in these two-day meetings in Salzburg, at Salzburg University of Applied Sciences, we tried, as with the Work Package 5 and Work Package 8, as well as other experts, to address two major issues. The first one is what partnership and tools do cities need to prevent violent radicalization in their local urban security strategies? And the second issue was how can cities in the Citizen Agora methodology to foster an inclusive public dialogue on the prevention of violent radicalization? So these are our internal meeting too. Then we have another workshop done by the University of Grenoble, which is the Work Package 6, the fight against failure and speech against speech. And they made a workshop on disseminating propaganda and indoctrination, discursive features of rapturing. So this is what was in May. And the last one was on October 2008, and it was the meeting of EFUS in Paris. It's a working group of cities done by EFUS. And if you want to, okay. You want to add something about this meeting? Oui. Yes. Mm-hmm. That's it. Okay. Then, our diffusion activity. As Serafin said, we had meetings with other European projects on radicalization. So there was this meeting with Safran. Safran, it was a workshop in collaboration with the we were four European projects, Safran, Practices, Risk Track, and Trivalent. And we discussed and presented the experience, the policies, and research action of the prevention of radicalization around three main themes: radicalization and the internet, radicalization and alternative discourse, and radicalization and civil society. And this is what was in Brussels, and it was kind of sharing. Safran was presenting. They finished their project, and they wanted to share their experience with the other European project H2020, and we were invited in this activity. Then there's another activity organized in Jan 2018, La Ville de Nice. They called the Euro Practices Day, and there was a presentation of practices to local actors, and we presented also how you can be an associate member and how you can share our experiences and collaborate with practices as a local actor. Then in the 6th of June, so I will not take back all what was said. It was the practices first year advance of results in Brussels, in Belgium, and here we presented the results of WP3 of Dunia Buzar expertise, the factors of the radical process, the risk factors of the radicalization, and the resistant factors, resistant and pro. This is what Serafin was talking about. And we presented the results of the European survey by Kantar, so you had all an overall about the result. And also l'Université de Grenoble-Alpes presented the results of their work, Hate Speech and Radicalization. So then in 19 June 2018, we, in the framework of our cooperation with the Parliamentary Mission for Education and Prevention of Radicalization, we made the parliament, the National Assembly, we presented the results of the European survey in the National Assembly. And it was very positive, and we had a colloquium just the next month about the radicalization too. So we are also in cooperation with deputies from the National Assembly in France. Okay, the last meeting that we had is the meeting of RAND Research Seminar Amsterdam in Netherlands, and it's Professor Root who attended this meeting. Participant projects were requested for future research priorities, and they discussed the following issues in this meeting. What are the current and future priority challenges, and how could we be addressed them? How to foster the dialogue between researchers, practitioners, and policymakers, which is very important, and how can the EU further support researchers? This is in general, and this is the last meeting that we had in this framework of. So, these are our meeting. Tomorrow, Luis will talk more about, but I will just give you an idea about today who are our associate members. We have among the city, the land of Berlin, the Senate Department of Education, Youth and Science of Berlin too, the commune of we have the commune de Liège, Regione Calabria, we have the Città di Palermo, the city of Malaga, the Leitung Austria, the Leitung okay. Then for the ONG and association, we have Save Belgium that work with them, Society Against Violent Extremism, and this is Saliha Benali in Belgium. We have Syrien Ne Bouge Agissant Dominique Pons en France. We have Youth ID and Yanis Lamarie France. Yanis is here. He's there. He's the Youth ID of the project. Alter Ego France, Les Militants des Savoirs. And as expert, we have Henri Qui Olivier, University of Rovira Virili, Spain. And I have the other name, but I couldn't find them. It was so this is the about what we did more or less this year. So I will just give you an idea about our how to be associate members in for practices. And it's not for the partners. So it's not for the partners, it's any. So I just. So the strong involvement of stakeholders is very important for our project. So we have, our project is open to any association from members. These members could be cities and or networks of cities that are interested in preventing violent radicalization, and they can be other organizations with no restrictions. It means universities, companies, individual experts, so we are open and to collaborate with these two stakeholders. As you can see, we have like a sheet here that you can, if you want, if you are interested, you can go on our website, practices.org, you will find it, or here, and see what can we do for and how can a stakeholder benefit from our project. So I will say quickly, the associate member will offer the interest organization individually the opportunity to provide comments and feedback, for instance, on the project drafts, to have access to all documents and tools from the project, to be acknowledged as contributor, participate as observers, participate in the case of cities, and this is in a dedicated working group that is led by EFUS, in the case of cities, increase organization visibility thanks to the practices project websites, receive the assistance of the practices management team, use, adapt, and translate their dissemination material of practices, and deploy the visual identity elements of practices in their own activities, publication, and websites. So please check this formula, and if you are interested, you can always send us. We need only your CV and your signature, and we'll answer back. So, is there any question? No. No question? You're tired? You're all tired? Okay. It was light, it was not complicated. So, thank you very much for all of you. Thank you.
Okay. Now, I have to give some practical information. To all the people involved in the project. I remember that we will have a dinner together on this night, and that the bus will leave hotel at 15 past 8. It's right? Okay. At 15 past 8. It seems to me that Russia sent you in the last 2 days information about dinner, it seems to me, yeah.
I send the information you sent me about the plan, the dinner,
It seems to me, yes. Okay, but about the on the place where we will have a dinner, and but otherwise, you can send today some hours before dinner, okay, so please. Since you are in a hotel, it seems to me that you are all in the same hotel, Aria Hotel. We will wait you in the hall. And tomorrow we will have a meeting. We will start. Yes. Okay. Tomorrow meeting will start at 9 o'clock. Seems to me. It's true. At 9 o'clock, and we will finish around 12. We will have a light lunch or brunch, and we will leave university by bus to go to La Mezia, where we will visit a center with immigrants, and we will have also the we will have a food with them, in the sense that these people will prepare an aperitif, light dinner, and around 6 p.m. For tomorrow, people who will leave from airport of La Mezia tomorrow on afternoon can have the opportunity to travel with us and to stop in the airport when and we will start the visit to La Mezia, because one or two of you asked me this one. So it's possible to leave you, because we will leave university around 30 past one, and so people who will have a flight on the afternoon can decide to stop in the airport. Other people after the dinner can came back by bus with here in Rende and in the hotel. Today the dinner is offered by University of Calabria, and today I'd like to communicate that all the dinner, all the food are prepared by young people involved who attend the secondary school in tourism, and many of these people are immigrants, and we will have the opportunity to meet them, and we chose this opportunity to meet also these people, also because we know that young people, Italian young people, need to be more trust in themselves. Tomorrow, the cost of the bus, the cost of food, of aperitif, is in charge of ourselves. The bus will cost about 15 euros, and the aperitifs about 20 euros. So all the afternoon will cost around 35 euros. Okay? So, and since we know that we need the receipt, we already communicate to people for tomorrow your name, and so you will have the receipt. Everyone can have the receipt on the bus and on the place where we will have the aperitif. I don't know if Anna Elia, few minutes of description of what tomorrow, of the visit of tomorrow, since okay, the dinner and the okay.
I sent you an email with the address where we're going. So we will eat in the will take place at the regional wine house in Cosenza, in the center of Cosenza, and this wine house is located inside an old church dedicated to Saint Marie of Constantinople. And it contains more than 1,600 wine bottles. So if you like wine, go to there. And what we will meet at 8:15 in front of Ariha Hotel. Okay? Okay, that's it. And I'm sure that everybody will come.
Okay? For tomorrow, Anna Elia, please some comments, some notes on... Yes.
Tomorrow in the afternoon at 15, at 3 p.m., we're going to visit Luna Rossa. It's a center for isolated minor in Lamezia. It is located in a house that is confiscated from mafia. Confiscated from. So we are going to visit this center. We are going to stay with an accompanied minor, overall with the Imam Khalid. They're going to stay with us, the cultural mediator of the center and the responsible of Progetto Sud, that is going to speak about the history of this social cooperative that stay in Lamezia. It's very engaged in the fighting mafia. Okay. So the visit is going to from 3 to 5:30, and then we have also a dinner offered, but we have to pay for that.
by host of this structure,
Sorry?
They are prepared by host, yes, of this structure.
Mm? Yeah.
Okay. By immigrants.
Thanks.
Okay. Cooperative of immigrants. Okay. The last thing, please, you should leave this in the hall. Okay, thank you. And so to come back to the hotel, you can take a bus, you can go by feet. Okay. Bye.